Good evening, everybody. My name is Dr. Priyadarshini Pandey. I am from MedGenome Labs. I welcome you all to this session event organized by MedGenome and Jindal IVF. Today's the topic of the webinar is going to be genetics for practicing obstetricians and pediatricians. I thank Jindal IVF for coming up with the idea of organizing this webinar, and we are extremely happy to partner with Jindal IVF on this event. So I will start by introducing the chairperson of this event, Dr. Umesh Jindal. I don't think she needs an introduction. Dr. Jindal is very well known in the community. She is the director of Jindal IVF and Sant Memorial Nursing Home. She specializes in infertility services and assisted reproduction in Chandigarh. In fact, she was one of the first pioneers to start this service in Chandigarh. And Jindal IVF remains as one of the top ranking IVF centers north of Delhi. So all kudos to her. She is the one who has been a pioneer in establishing this facility. And it is a wonderful facility, as all of you already know about it. So Dr. Jindal has about numerous publications in both national and international journals. She has several chapters in books. Her field of interest is mainly infertility and fertility preservation. She has been very active in adapting genetics as it is moving ahead. She is interested in genetic counseling of tuberculosis. Dr. Jindal has also received many honors and awards, fellowships in maternal fetal medicine from the University of Washington, Seattle, USA. She has fellowships in IVF, ICSI at the Institute of Human Reproduction in Kolkata. Short-term fellowship in reproductive sciences associates from Kansas City, USA. And again, a host of awards that have been given to her from various societies. She was the role model in 2004 at the annual day celebrations from Capstone's Women's Day. She was a jury finalist and awarded Woman of the Year by Dainik Bhaskar. She was awarded LIC Madhurima Editor's Choice Award of Bhaskar Women of the Year in the year 2011. She has been awarded Excellence in Healthcare by the Society of Promotion of Ethical and Affordable Healthcare. And she has been awarded the Icon of the Year IVF National Fertility Awards 2019 by Economic Times. So with this introduction, I will also go through the presenters who will be presenting in this webinar. So our first speaker will be Dr. Sangeeta Khatte. She is a DNP Medical Genetics from Institute of Medical Genetics and Genomics, Sir Gangaram Hospital, New Delhi. She is consultant medical genetics at Jindal IVF, Sant Memorial Hospital. And she has many research publications in national and international journals. Okay. Our second presenter will be Dr. Ritika Bajaj. She is MS Obstetrics and Gynae. She has a fellowship in maternal fetal medicine from AIIMS, New Delhi. And she also has qualifications in medical genetics from SGPGI, Lucknow. She is currently consultants obstetrics, gynecology, and fetal medicine at Jindal IVF. Her main interests are basically prenatal screening, invasive diagnostic testing, non-immune high drops, Rh isoimmunization, IUGR, and twin pregnancies. She has several international and national publications to her credit. Final speaker for the day will be Dr. Sheetal Jindal. She is a consultant at Jindal IVF and Sant Memorial Nursing Home in Chandigarh. And her areas of interest include infertility and IVF, PGD and PGS. That is pre-implantation genetic diagnostics and andrology. So without further ado, I will hand over the mic to Dr. Umesh Jindal for a few words, following which we can start the session. Dr. Jindal, please.
Thank you, Priyadarshini. And also thanks to MedGenome for hosting this event for us. And I welcome all the delegates who have come and joined us to hear our experience, our viewpoints on many of these issues. Just to introduce that we are now trying to establish a reproductive genetic unit with the name of Baby Genie. We'll be coming out with a launch soon. This Baby Genie concept, we have options for diagnosing genetic problems pre-pregnancy in the children, and giving reproductive choices to the patients, and reproductive choices, carrying out these reproductive choices like prenatal testing, and also option of opting for pre-implantation genetic testing for various genetic disorders. It is a very complex subject, and we have a very dynamic team with us. Dr. Sangeeta, who is a qualified geneticist and a very hardworking person, goes to the core of every case and tries to find the diagnosis. Dr. Ritika, a very brilliant fetal medicine expert, and Dr. Sheetal, who has been in IVF field giving beautiful results and now specializing in PGT, and from core of her heart, she believes that genetic diseases should be eliminated from the family. And we will listen to them one by one. And I invite Dr. Sangeeta. She will be talking about cerebral palsy. Cerebral palsy has been a topic of, or bone of contention between pediatricians and obstetricians, because we try to blame each other, while the blame actually goes to some genetic disorder. And also, this is a very common cause of medico-legal litigations. So if we are aware of the genetic causes, we can investigate, we can save ourselves, and we should know where to do genetic testing and what genetic testing. So Dr. Sangeeta will elaborate on cerebral palsy, a very common problem, where pediatricians and obstetricians both, you know, are at loss what to do and what, how to explain to the patient what has gone wrong. Dr. Sangeeta, please.
Good evening, everyone. And thank you for your kind introduction, Umesh ma'am. That's very nice of you. So I'm going to discuss today various aspects of cerebral palsy, relation to birth asphyxia or genetic disorders. So my components will be definition, types of CP. Pronounce it as CP only, because it's easy to tell also. So pathophysiology of CP, birth asphyxia versus cerebral palsy, what is the evidence, and evidence supporting genetic etiology, disorders mimicking CP, and various case scenarios where we have encountered patients as a clinical diagnosis of CP, and then we found certain genetic diagnosis in these patients, and preventive strategies for CP, what we can do. So first to start with, I will start with the definition. CP is an umbrella term, which incorporates non-progressive permanent disorders of movement, tone, or posture, leading to limitation of the activity. And basically, involvement is predominantly motor. And this is the common cause of motor disability in children, and with a prevalence of 2 to 3 per 1,000 live births, and which is much more, than any other disorder. And surprisingly, in countries with consanguineous marriages, endogamous marriages, it accounts for 4 to 5 per 1,000 live births. And in India also comes under the scanner, where consanguineous marriages, they account for up to 30% of the cases. So now we can imagine how much cerebral palsy we can have. So basically, what are the presentations of a CP child? I already told that it's predominantly motor. And first and the most common presentation is spastic. 80 to 90% cases, they are presented with a spastic type of CP, where muscles become stiff and tight. And the pathology is there in the motor cortex. And second presentation, most common, is the dyskinetic, where a child presents with the involuntary movements or, tonic posturing of the body, and chorea, athetosis. And the culprit is the basal ganglia, basically injury to the basal ganglia or lesion in the basal ganglia that leads to the dyskinetic feature of the CP. And third presentation is the ataxic, which is seen in 5% of the cases. And it is characterized by shaky movements, tremors, or falling down, recurrent falls. The patient will come with a history of recurrent falls and loss of balance. And the pathology basically most of the time is in cerebellum, which controls the coordination. And fourth presentation is mixed type. So they can be presentation with spastic plus dyskinetic, ataxic plus dyskinetic, or any mixture. So a number of children present with this mixed type of presentation. That is why, the clinical picture is so heterogeneous that we can't really differentiate a CP case with a genetic problem. So, and there is frequent association with the intellectual disability, epilepsy, sensory, vision or hearing loss. And with these comorbidities, we should definitely be skeptical about a associated genetic disorder in any child of CP. What are the pathophysiology? You all know cerebral insult in any form in the developing fetal or infant brain from birth to 1 or even 2 years of age. And insult is mostly anterolateral in 80% of cases. If I account for the placental or maternal causes, they are also there. But definitely genetic disorders can also present antenatally. Perinatal 10% and postnatal. And, we all know that most common, traditional, you can say, or presumed causes are hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy, which has been, replaced by neonatal encephalopathy now, and bilirubin toxicity, birth trauma, intrauterine infection, neonatal encephalitis. We always, think about these causes, and we have just this, frame of mind that we will always think first about these causes, and it is always good to think about the common causes, no doubt. But various epidemiological studies, they are quoting up to 30 to 70% cases of cerebral palsy, they are related to the genetic causes. And this is much more surprising for any of us. So birth asphyxia, it is usually implicated as a cause of cerebral palsy. But, I have gone through many studies. Total CP burden due to birth asphyxia is, less than 2 to less than 10% of cases merely. And a recent study I have seen that accounted only less than 2% cases of birth asphyxia as a cause of cerebral palsy. And babies labeled with birth asphyxia due to low Apgar score often don't have primary asphyxia. And, that pre-existing conditions like birth defects, inborn error of metabolism, or other genetic disorders, they may predispose them to fetal distress during labor and birth and eventually cerebral hypoxia. And we may mislead it as, as a misdiagnosis of intrapartum asphyxia as a culprit. Most of the cases, it is a human tendency, And birth asphyxia, so, because of considering birth asphyxia as a major cause of CP, we have increased rate of defensive obstetric interventions like intrapartum electronic fetal heart monitoring, cesarean section. But various studies are coming up. They have, quoted that these all interventions have failed to decrease the CP rates. This clearly indicates there is some underlying genetic condition preceding the labor and birth and are much larger contribution to CP burden than birth asphyxia. So what are the various studies, what literature says evidence supporting the genetic contribution of CP? So concordance rate, that means, same trait in two individuals. So that is higher in the monozygotic twins than in dizygotic twins. As we all know that monozygotic twins share the same genetic material. So the genetic propensity for having the genetic cause is more. And risk of CP is significantly higher in the consanguineous families. So that is again an indication to be a genetic factor involved. And there is frequent co-occurrence of CP with intellectual disability, encephalopathy, epilepsy, dysmorphic features, and congenital anomalies. That is why it is very, very difficult to differentiate the clinical overlap. Many genetic disorders have clinical overlapping clinical features, and even MRI findings are sometimes similar to the leukoencephalopathy. Like, you know, in CP, we usually consider periventricular leukomalacia as a, you know, hallmark of CP. But periventricular leukomalacia is seen in many other conditions, many other genetic conditions also. I can quote many Pelizaeus-Merzbacher disease, X-linked adrenoleukodystrophy, Krabbe disease, MLD. So there are so many conditions which can overlap with the CP findings. And now various studies are coming up which have shown single gene mutations in number of cerebral palsy degrees. So what can be the genetic contribution to CP? That can be chromosomal copy number variation. We all know that is detected by microarray most of the cases. Microdeletions or micro duplications. They account for 10 to 12% of the cases of CP. And main genes which are involved are CAMP1, WDR45, HSPA4, and SPAST gene. So whenever there is a loss of copy number and indicating these genes, so we should be skeptical about the genetic cause, definitely. And you will be surprised to know that more single gene disorders, 800 genes, more than 800 genes are there for cerebral palsy in OMIM, which is an online database for Mendelian inheritance genes. And they represent more than 900 clinical conditions which are related to cerebral palsy. And of course, most of them belong to inborn errors of metabolism. So this is a very crowded slide, but I have to show it to you just to, you know, make a clear picture in the mind. So many disorders are mimicking CP. I have given only one slide, and because all the causes are beyond scope of my presentation. So as I already told the types of CP, so spastic kind of CP can be present in a few disorders like hereditary spastic paraplegia, arginase deficiency, which is a urea cycle disorder, one gene called COL4 collagen gene related spastic CP, biotinase deficiency. These are many syndromes. They clearly, you know, overlap with the CP phenotype, and that is spastic phenotype. And second one as the disorder which present with dyskinetic kind of CP. And most of them are cerebral neurotransmitter deficiency, glucose transporter. These are organic aciduria's and creatine deficiency syndromes. And disorders which mimic with the ataxic CP. These are also there, you know, there is a long list, and there is much more longer list than this. I'm just giving the glimpse of the disorders involved. And these are the common disorders I've already mentioned, urea cycle disorder, neurotransmitter deficiency. So they all, their clinical picture definitely can mimic CP. And various studies are being done for whole exome sequencing, genetic testing to find out the cerebral palsy genes. And this is the recent study I have quoted. You may not be able to see it properly, but this was the diagnostic yield of exome sequencing in patients with cerebral palsy, and published in Feb 2021 only. They have taken a cohort of 1, 3, 4, 5 patients, and yield was seen 32.7% in pediatric patients and 10.5% in adults. So these all were the genetic diagnosis. And you know, this previous study was done in a mixed patient, you know, mixed population, like with the family history or without sporadic cases. But this study has been done in sporadic cases of CP without any family history. And they have found, you can see the list of genes they have found. It is a very large list of the genes we have found with the sporadic cases without family history. Because most of the time we try to find out if family member is affected, then we will go for the genetic testing. This is not true in every case. So while evaluating a child with CP, although these slides may not be belonging to the obstetricians, but definitely a pediatrician can definitely grasp it. So what are the red flag signs which are pointing to genetic etiology of a CP child? in history, if there is no risk factor like prematurity, low birth weight, jaundice, the nectarous, hypoglycemia, intrapartum asphyxia, head injury, intracranial hemorrhage, infection, or stroke, anything predisposing to CP is not there. And if there is a positive family history or history of consanguinity, so progressive neurological symptoms of the child, usually CP is, you know, like a non-progressive. The lesion has occurred and it will not, you know, progress in terms of neurological symptoms. But if there is progression in the symptoms, definitely we should think of genetic etiology. And if the child has attained some milestones, but there is regression after achievement, that is clear indication for genetic testing. And paroxysmal symptoms in relation to time of the day, diet, fasting, activity. Because many genetic disorders like, I would say, GLUT1 deficiency, neurotransmitter deficiency, they all vary with the time of the day as well as diet, fasting. So this again points to the genetic etiology. On examination of the child, obviously the dysmorphic features, everybody knows that that is a clear indication. Isolated motor involvement, like isolated ataxia, isolated hypotonia without dystonia, that also lead to a genetic clue. And mostly in CP cases, there is no involvement of peripheral nervous system. If it is there, we should definitely think of something genetic. Eye movement abnormalities like oculogyric crisis, oculomotor apraxia. There is basically a defect in the saccadic movements of the eyes. And in fundoscopy, so in every case of CP who has seizures or any neurological signs, we should definitely get the fundoscopy of the child to find out any eye finding or retinopathy, retinal pigmentary changes to find out the genetic etiology, because many genetic disorders present with the cherry red spot or any other retina optic atrophy or retinal pigmentary changes. And MRI brain, usually in 80% of the CP cases, MRI brain has some kind of finding. But if it is a normal finding, that again point to the diagnosis, genetic diagnosis, because many genetic disorders like urea cycle disorder, neurotransmitter deficiency, they will not have any findings in MRI. And isolated basal ganglia involvement. Basal ganglia basically is the part of the gray matter of the brain which controls the movements. So extra pyramidal involvement, that will lead to the extra pyramidal involvement if the basal ganglia involvement is there. So especially the globus pallidus part of the basal ganglia, that will definitely point to certain genetic diagnosis. And images, MRI images must be seen in a CP child that can be pathognomic of specific genetic conditions like glutaric aciduria or Joubert syndrome, where there is a molar tooth sign. I don't want to discuss the MRI because that will take whole evening. So a few specific genetic conditions, they are presenting with the typical MRI features. I will present in few of my cases also. So why we are concerned about the genetic testing, why we want the exact diagnosis in a CP child? So it is important for family, child, for clinician, for community, for everybody is very important. So for family, relief of anxiety, and you know, they don't feel guilt also. That like they have, hello? So they don't feel guilty. There is some disturbance, I think. Hello? Anybody can hear me?
We can hear you, madam. Please go ahead.
Okay. So we can definitely give the reproductive choices for the family, and family is also relieved of anxiety as well as guilt that, okay, we have done whatever we could do. And after the genetic diagnosis, you know, there is some kind of surety in the mind, okay, we know about the recurrence now, and we can plan our reproductive choices as per our status. And for child, obviously we can prognosticate the age of the child or complications, treatment options of if child is detected to have inborn error of metabolism. There are so many treatments available for inborn error of metabolism nowadays if detected early. So we can predict the upcoming morbidities in the child and guide the patient according to that. for clinician, now it comes to the obstetrician as well as pediatrician. As Dr. Jindal already mentioned about the litigation, in this litigation era, we should be aware of everything, and genetic diagnosis definitely can save the obstetrician as well as pediatrician from this litigation, and they can have a clear answer to everything. And for community, yes, if we have diagnosed a syndrome, a genetic condition, so the research institutes get activated to for the therapeutic researches related to that particular diagnosis, and that can definitely it's going to affect other children also. As you must have heard the newer gene therapy, Zolgensma for SMA, spinal muscular atrophy, which has been given in India also, although it is very expensive and people are procuring it with the help of government and NGOs. So this is very good. Now I would like to discuss few case scenarios of children who presented in a CP-like picture and final diagnosis of genetic condition was made. So this is my first case. This was a 4-year-old girl born to non-consanguineous parents. As you can see, there is no family history of any other condition. She was brought with a label of CP, and she had a global developmental delay with failure to thrive. Birth was a full-term forceps delivery, 3.3 kg, feeble cry at birth, and neonatal. She started having neonatal seizures at 9th hour of birth. She had NICU stay till day 8 of life. And she had severe feeding difficulties, and seizures were controlled on anti-epileptics. Currently, child. So I examined the child, and non-communicative child. Head lag was there, no speech. On faces, typical features I could see. There was bitemporal narrowing of the forehead, and vertical frowning of the forehead, antiverted ears, and significant head lag was there, and hypotonia as well as exaggerated deep tendon reflexes on neurological examination. And her MRI brain was very specific. So as you can see, no need to read this whole MRI. I have just put make a picture that, okay, this is a normal MRI and this is abnormal MRI. As you can see into this normal MRI, we can see these are the this is the cortical area where we can see the dipping parts as sulci and elevated parts as gyri. So in this picture, we can see the gyri are so much flattened and cortex is so much thickened. Here you can see this is the cortex and this is so thin, and this is looking like more than 10 mm. And there is subcortical band, which is very abnormal. And this is a typical feature of few conditions. And one of them is a microdeletion syndrome, which is called Miller-Dicker syndrome. So clinical diagnosis was made on the basis of genetic clues. So there was no predisposing peripartum factors at birth for neonatal seizure. Typical facial features, MRI findings were suggestive. So we did the FISH, fluorescent in situ hybridization, because that is commonly available with us for microdeletion on 17p 13.3, and final diagnosis of Miller-Dicker syndrome was made in a CP child. So these Miller-Dicker syndrome is mostly de novo and can be inherited in few cases, and parents were consulted about the recurrence, and parents were tested. They were not carrier of the disease. So, but recurrence is still there more than general population if de novo, because of germline mosaicism, and 50% if one variant is a carrier, and parents were given the reproductive choices, prenatal diagnosis for in next pregnancy, and PGT was not advised in this case. But if inherited, we can definitely advise PGT also. Now coming over to the case two, she was a 1.5-year-old boy, which was again diagnosed as a cerebral palsy case, and he had global delay, failure to thrive. Birth was full-term CS, fetal distress, meconium stain, 3 kg, cried immediately, good Apgar score. And day two, he had lethargy, refusal to feed, became hypotonic, and eventually landed up into encephalopathy. And he was kept on ventilator till day 6 of life. And he had, after discharge, he is getting recurrent admissions due to lethargic episodes. And you can say decompensation attacks. And on taking the family history, he had previous sibling, male sibling, expired at in neonatal period. Uneventful birth, early neonatal death on day 5 of life. Initial event was again the same as that of his current sibling. Lethargy and refusal to feed at 22nd hour, followed by encephalopathy and sequelae of events. The patient attendants, they didn't know much about this. And no DNA was stored. So, examination, there was no facial dysmorphism. Child was unable to sit unsupported, hypotonic, and deep tendon reflexes were exaggerated on neurological examination. Investigation on brain MRI, there was no specific finding. And ammonia was a bit high, on higher side, because we, in children, we take 80 milligram per deciliter as a limit. And it was 190 milligram per deciliter on test, on random testing. And a metabolic screen was also negative. So in this case, so what was the suggestive of genetic etiology? Two consecutive affected children, decompensation episodes in the current child, high serum ammonia levels, and normal MRI. So we did the whole exome sequencing for the child, and there was a hemizygous pathogenic variation in the exon 4 of OTC gene, which was a missense variation. And final diagnosis of ornithine transcarbamylase deficiency was made, which is OTC deficiency, we call it. It is a urea cycle disorder. And parents were tested. Obviously, mother was tested because it is an X-linked condition. So mother was carrier of this same variation. And then the counseling was given, and diet management was given. X-linked recessive. So we told them that recurrence is in 50% of the male children. And it is a treatable condition if diagnosed in time. So we gave them the diet advice, low protein diet, diet chart was made, and emergency management regime was also given. And reproductive options, obviously the prenatal diagnosis and PGTM can also be performed in these cases. So case 3, 5 years old boy, born to non-consanguineous parents with a negative family history, delayed motor milestones, birth was preterm cesarean, 2 kg, delayed cry, floppy child, severe feeding difficulties, significant delay in motor milestones, could sit unsupported for a while. And other milestones were age appropriate. So anthropometry, like height, weight, and head circumference was age appropriate. But child has typical open mouth appearance, elongated face, which is usually seen in the congenital myopathies, myotonic dystrophies. And child had significant hypotonia with absent deep tendon reflexes. So pointers to the genetic etiology in case 3 were significant isolated hypotonia, faces typical of congenital myopathy or myotonic dystrophy, and absent deep tendon reflexes. So we did the whole exome sequencing, and there was homozygous pathogenic deletion of two base pairs in LAMA2 gene, which is responsible for merosin-deficient congenital muscular dystrophy. This is an autosomal recessive disorder with 25% risk of affected children, 50% of being carrier, and 25% of being normal children. Reproductive options were again given, prenatal diagnosis, PGTM, pregnancy with alternative gamete. And, after making this diagnosis, parents were also sure, and physiotherapies and all we advised, which are usually recommended in these myopathies. So in last case is case 4, 9 months old boy, and no family history, non-consanguineous parents, delayed milestones. And birth was full term CS, fetal distress, cried immediately, low Apgar score, 5 by 10 and 6 by 10 was reported somewhere. So admitted in NICU, discharged on day 7, neck folding was at 4 months. And recently, since last 1 month, patient noted to have intermittent twisting of the limbs and body in the child. So they brought child to us. And on examination, child was having macrocephaly more than 4 Z-score and dystonic posturing in between. Dystonic posturing is basically sudden sustained contraction of the muscles. So, and exaggerated reflexes on neurological examination. MRI brain was again a typical of certain condition. This is the normal brain MRI where we can see no gaps. So as we can see here there are a few gaps, hyperechogenic, and this is we call it widening of the sylvian fissure. These are the sylvian fissure and they are widened. Basically, there is lack of cortical tissue here. So this was the typical finding of this case, and pointers again, no predisposing factor to low FGAR, macrocephaly, progressive neurological features, MRI findings, and again we did the exome sequencing, and there was homozygous likely pathogenic variation in GCDH gene. This was a missense change, and final diagnosis of glutaric aciduria type 1 was made, in which the MRI is typical of this syndrome, widening of the sylvian fissures, and dystonic posturing is again very common in glutaric aciduria. So the child presented like a dyskinetic CP because the child had dystonic posturing. So anybody could confuse it with the CP. But again, this was the genetic diagnosis, and this is an inborn error of metabolism and treatable organic aciduria due to defect in the glutarylCoA dehydrogenase enzyme in the metabolism of lysine amino acid. And treatment chart was given to attendants. Lysine control diet, carnitine, riboflavin was prescribed. And this is one of the disorder that can be picked by newborn screening. So newborn in TMS, all pediatricians, I think obstetricians are also aware about the TMS right now, tandem mass spectrometry. So that shows an increased glutaryl carnitine on TMS. If it is increased, we can be suspicious of this diagnosis. And in urine GCMS, this is gas chromatography mass spectrometry. If there is increased 3-hydroxyglutaric acid in urine, that is again pointing to the diagnosis of glutaric aciduria. And this is an autosomal recessive condition with 25% risk of recurrence and reproductive choices as like any other autosomal recessive disorders. So I have, been repeatedly saying that whole exome sequencing. So I would just give this slide. Just
Sangeeta, you have to run it fast.
Yes, ma'am. Last year, bas.
Okay.
Two slides are. So these are the scale of genomic variation. Although Dr. Ritika is going to explain everything in detail, but this is the chromosome, and chromosome has 100 million base pairs. So these are the scales of genetic variation. If we want to see grossly the chromosomes, we have to get the karyotype done. And if we want to go to see details of the chunk of the chromosome, then we have to go for the copy number variation testing, and that is done by microarray studies. And if we go more deeper inside the chunk to find out the nucleotide changes, then we have to go for this next generation sequencing, which includes clinical exome, gene panels, whole exome sequence, whole genome sequence. Clinical exome basically only 4,000 to 5,000 pathogenic OMIM genes. Gene panels, depending upon the system of the body involved, like liver panel, metabolic liver panel, or neurology panel. And whole exome sequence, it includes all the coding portions of the 20,000 genes, whole genome coding as well as non-coding portions of the genes. So what are the proposed measures we can apply to patients to prevent them from CP? So carrier screening, especially in consanguineously married couple, we can advise them to go for carrier screening before planning their pregnancy, so that we can find the pathogenic gene if they are carrier of, and make the reproductive choices in hand. And newborn screening for common treatable genetic condition, we are doing in India at some places, but not in every state. And expanded newborn screening can be done by tandem mass spectrometry, and it can screen at least 80 to 100 genetic disorders. And details I'm not discussing. And PGT, obviously, if single gene disorder or any disorder is known in the family. So take home message from my side is today that child with developmental delay cannot be labeled as CP without extensive genetic workup. Birth asphyxia accounts for only very small proportion of CP and could be a sequelae to underlying genetic disorder. Exome sequencing has given new direction into the causes of cerebral palsy and challenged previous medico-legal assumption about the culpability of treating clinician. I think everybody would agree with me in this point. and diagnostic yield of genetic testing can increase from 14% in the unselected clinical cases to 57% if clinically selected after rigorous work up by trained geneticists. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Sangeeta.
Thank you, ma'am.
In any case of Seripad policy, what I got was that you recommend that every patient or every child should have a genetic consultation and
yes,
genetic testing.
Yes, ma'am.
And the more important, we may not be able to help the child, but reproductive choices, medical legal things, and in many cases, the child also may be helped.
Yes, ma'am.
And a significant, because inborn error of metabolism are, I think, relatively common cause of CP.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. And maybe the audience can think of some more questions. And we move on to our next talk by Dr. Ritika Bajaj. And this is a talk which obviously interests most of the obstetricians, because microarray is the one test which has now been recommended for all cases of abortions or prenatal testing, and it is not easy to interpret the report. So we'll ask Dr. Ritika how to go about and why microarray instead of karyotype, and in which cases, and how to interpret and how to get help in these cases. And I think Dr. Ritika, you should take over.
Thank you so much, ma'am. At the outset, I would like to thank MedGenome for giving us this platform. Without wasting any more time, I will now move on to my talk, which is on microarray in obstetrics. So are my slides visible?
Yes, go on.
Yeah. So in this presentation, we will discuss as to what is a microarray, what does a microarray detect, what does the microarray not detect, how do we interpret the results of a microarray report? Which patients in obstetric practice could benefit from it? How do we use these results clinically? And what are the dilemmas with the use of microarray in prenatal diagnosis? Now, we all know, as Dr. Sangeeta just discussed, that there are three main groups of genetic disorders. The first is the classical chromosome disorders, which include the full aneuploidies like the Down syndrome and the Turner syndrome, and the partial aneuploidies, where the deletion or duplication is of sufficient size that it can be seen on a microscope. So these are the disorders which used to be picked up on a traditional karyotype. And over here, the phenotype is practically always abnormal. Now, the second group of disorders is the microdeletion or the microduplication syndromes, where we have copy number variations. So these are the small imbalances which cannot be picked up on a standard karyotype. And these may not always lead to a clinical abnormality. The third group of disorders are the Mendelian disorders, where we have a mutation at a single genetic locus. So we may have a change of a base pair, and these can be autosomal dominant, recessive, X-linked or Y-linked. So in our talk today, we'll be focusing on the microdeletion, microduplication disorders, which are picked up by a microarray. So in the past decade, there has been a boom in the diagnostic capability of prenatal genetic tests. So from the era of the standard karyotype, we have now moved on to microarrays. Microarrays have almost completely replaced karyotype at several centers, because these are able to pick up the small deletion duplications like the 22q11 deletion syndrome, in addition to all the abnormalities which used to be picked up by a standard karyotype, or most of the abnormalities. On the horizon are the genomic technologies like the whole genome sequencing and the exome sequencing, which we have now started using prenatally also in certain specific cases. Now, what exactly is a chromosomal microarray? So before we move to that, we need to understand that what are the copy number variants. So copy number variants are the duplicated or deleted segments of DNA, which are at least 1,000 base pairs in size, and which differ from a representative reference genome. So all of us have two copies of these segments in our DNA. Now, when a small copy is missing in one of our chromosomes, it means that there is a change in the copy number now from 2 to 1 copies. If we have a microduplication, then it means that we have an extra copy of that segment of DNA. So we have 3 copies. So that again is a change in the copy number. And that is what a microarray is going to detect. So a standard karyotype can pick up deletions and duplications which are large in size, which are more than 5 MB in size. So they can be picked up on a karyotype. But the smaller deletions and duplications, they will not be seen under a microscope, and they require sophisticated technology which is provided by the microarray. So do all copy number changes cause disease? So we all know that we all look different, we act different, we are different because our DNAs are also different. So all copy number changes, that is all small losses or gains of DNA, do not necessarily mean that there will be a disease. ACMG, which is the American College of Medical Genetics, has recommended that variants identified on a microarray should be classified into one of the five categories. So these could be pathogenic or likely pathogenic. These could be benign or likely benign, or these could be variants of uncertain significance. So when we get a microarray report which shows that the particular microdeletion or duplication is pathogenic or likely pathogenic, I think it's easy to counsel the parents, or comparatively easy, because we can tell them that, okay, there is a high chance that there is going to be a problem. If it is...
Achha.
Benign or likely benign, where there is a high possibility that it will not cause a disease. The most problematic for clinicians is the variants of uncertain significance, because simply speaking, it means that we do not know what this means, either because there is less information available at present, or it could be that the same variant is now found in pathogenic as well as non-pathogenic population. So these are the ones which actually trouble us the most. Now, how does a microarray report look and what does it detect? So I'll present it in the form of a case. So we had a 32 years old primi gravida, IVF conception. She had a nuchal translucency. The baby had a nuchal translucency of 2.2 millimeters in the NTNB scan, which was more than the 95th centile for that CRL. Her combined first trimester screening risk of trisomy 21 was 1 in 750, which is an intermediate risk group. So we did the counseling, and then we did an early level 2 ultrasound, which suggested a persistent left superior vena cava in the baby and no other significant malformation. So we counseled the parents. The parents opted for amniocentesis, and we did a microarray in the fetal sample. So let us see what the microarray looks at. So we were able to look at the common autosomal aneuploidies. So we looked at Downs, Edwards, and Patau's. So all these were negative. Microarray also looked at sex chromosomal aneuploidies, Turner's, Jacobs, Klinefelter's, XXX syndrome. All these were negative. So the microarray also then looked at triploidy, which one again negative. So most of the newer microarray platforms are able to detect triploidy, but it's always a good idea to actually check with the lab whether triploidy will be detected or not, because there are some platforms which may not pick it up. So this becomes important, especially if you are doing microarray in cases with early onset growth restriction, where triploidy might be the cause. Then the microarray also looked at the common microdeletion syndromes, which are mentioned over here. And they also looked at regions of homozygosity. So all these were absent in the couple, in the fetus. And because we know that persistent left superior vena cava if isolated has a generally good outcome, so we counseled the parents that we will be following up the baby for any left outflow tract obstruction, and the parents opted to continue the pregnancy. So this is how a microarray helped us in this case. Now, here's another case where we had a primi gravida, 13 weeks of gestation. The nuchal translucency was grossly abnormal, 5.5 millimeters, more than the 99th centile. So the parents opted for a chorionic villus sampling, and this is the microarray report. So what does this microarray report mean? So first of all, in this array, we are dealing with chromosome 15. So this is here, this is how the chromosome 15 looks like in the etiogram. Now, there are three copies. So this is into three. So whatever microdeletion of microduplication is there, so how do we make out? So there are three copies. If there is a microdeletion, this would be into one. So here we had a gain on chromosome 15. And what is the cytoband involved? It is from Q23. So here this is the Q23 region, and here this is Q24.1. So here there is a microduplication in the fetus. Now, the report also mentioned that the size of this microduplication was 4.7 MB. So this might have been missed on a standard karyotype. It is less than the 5 MB cutoff for the karyotype, which we mentioned. And there are total 53 genes in this region. So this is associated with 15q partial trisomy, and there can be severe mental deficiency, congenital heart disease, hand anomalies, and facial dysmorphism in this fetus or in this genetic syndrome. So the parents opted for a termination of pregnancy. So now this is a very old paper published in 2009 in the American Journal of Medical Genetics. And this just shows as to how the phenotype-genotype correlation can be achieved with a microarray. So the authors here studied chromosome 13. And as you can see here, they found that with the help of a microarray, they were able to identify that if you have a microdeletion in this area, you will get micrognathia in the fetus. If you have a microdeletion in the distal terminal part, you will have microcephaly. Here you will have cortical heterotopias. So basically what it means is that microarray is able to pinpoint to a much better detail compared to karyotype as to what the expected phenotype would be, depending upon the region involved and depending upon the genes which are there in the region. So I think now we all know what does a microarray detect. So as we saw, microarray can detect all the aneuploidies, which were able to pick up earlier on the karyotype, like trisomy 21, monosomy X, Edwards and Patau's. In addition, we can pick up microdeletions or microduplications of chromosomal segments, which are too small to be seen under microscope. Most of the platforms, especially the SNP-based platforms, can also detect triploidies, tetraploidies, loss of heterozygosity, and mosaicism when it is greater than 20 to 25%. So if out of 100 cells, there are 30 cells which are showing trisomy 21 and 70 cells have a normal karyotype or a normal chromosomal complement, that is a 30% mosaicism that can be picked up on a microarray. However, if out of 100 cells, only 10 cells have trisomy 21 and 90 are normal, then the microarray may miss that. And that is one limitation that we need to be aware of. And that is how we counsel the parents also, that not all genetic abnormalities can be picked up by a microarray. So what does a microarray not detect? I think this is also equally important. So very small deletions and duplications can be missed. Microarray is based upon the technology where you have probes on a gene chip or a slide. So if a genomic region is not represented on the platform, it will not be detected. When you have tiny duplications and deletions in a single gene, like you have Fragile X syndrome with trinucleotide repeats, that cannot be picked up on a microarray. Balanced rearrangements, like balanced translocations and inversions, cannot be picked up. However, majority of balanced rearrangements have a normal outcome, so we are not too worried about missing those. Point mutations in the sequence of single genes, like thalassemias and skeletal dysplasias, cannot be picked up. As we discussed, mosaicism below 20 to 25% cannot be picked. Some platforms do not detect triploidy and loss of heterozygosity. Another important thing is that the mechanism of a genetic imbalance cannot be detected on a microarray. So if the microarray report shows Down syndrome, then you have to in the end do a karyotype to find out whether there are three copies of chromosome 21 or whether it is because of a Robertsonian translocation. This does not mean much for the pregnancy at present, but this becomes important when we are counseling about the recurrence risk. Now, which patients in obstetrics benefit from microarray? So in the recent years, microarray has now found a huge role in fetuses where there is a thick nuchal translucency, where there is a congenital malformation or a structural anomaly, where there is fetal growth restriction, where there is stillbirth, recurrent pregnancy loss or balanced translocation carrier parents. So now let's look at the role of microarray in thick nuchal translucency. So this was a systematic review and meta-analysis published in the White Journal in 2015. And they looked at almost 17 studies. Most of these studies were using a cutoff of NT more than 3.5 millimeters. And they found that when you had fetuses with only increased nuchal translucency, your microarray was able to detect a genetic abnormality in 4% extra cases compared to a standard karyotype. And when you had an increased nuchal translucency with other malformations, this number increased to a 7% incremental yield. So this is a very significant number when you are dealing with a fetus with thick NT. So based upon this and several other papers which came in the subsequent years, now most of the guidelines recommend microarray instead of karyotype whenever you are doing genetic testing for a fetus with nuchal translucency more than 3.5 millimeters. Both the Canadian and guidelines and the RCOG recommend microarray if NT is more than 3.5 millimeters. Now, do we need to bring this cutoff down? So there has been a lot of debate recently as to whether this 3.5 millimeter cutoff is high and whether we need to bring it down and are we missing fetuses with abnormalities. So this was a paper which came from Israel in 2017. And they basically divided all the fetuses who were undergoing invasive testing into three groups. The first was the group where the NT was less than 2.9 millimeters. The fetuses were undergoing invasive testing either because of advanced maternal age or because of a genetic abnormality in the previous child. The second group was with NT between 3 to 3.4 millimeters. And the third group was where the NT was more than 3.5 millimeters. So this group, we clearly know we need microarray. But even in the group where the NT was between 3 to 3.4 millimeters, there were 170 fetuses. And they found that in 6.5% of these fetuses, there was a pathogenic copy number variation identified on microarray. So they recommended that microarray should be done even in fetuses who have mildly increased nuchal translucency between 3 to 3.4 millimeters. So at our center, we have almost completely replaced karyotype with microarray, especially when we are doing testing in fetuses with a thick nuchal translucency. Now, the second group is when you're doing prenatal testing by amni or CVS. We mainly do this testing in two big groups. So one is when there is a structural malformation in the baby. So there might be a CNS abnormality, a heart disease, cleft lip palate, omphalocele, etc. Or sometimes we do an invasive testing when there is only an increased risk of aneuploidy and the baby structurally looks normal. Or there could be advanced maternal age, or sometimes there is a genetic abnormality in previous child. So this was a landmark paper published almost 10 years ago in the New England Journal of Medicine, NEJM. And they looked at microarray versus karyotyping for prenatal diagnosis across 29 centers, over 4,000 women. And all their amniotic fluid and CV samples, they divided into two parts. On one part, they did a standard karyotype, and on the other part, they did a microarray. So these were the indications here. So these were the early days. So NIPT was probably not that much available. So most of their cases were undergoing testing because of advanced maternal age. But 1/4 of the babies had some anomaly on the ultrasound. 18% of the babies had a positive Down syndrome screening result. So they found that even in those early days, microarray was able to give you a result in 98.8% of the cases. So it's a very robust test. You get a report. 88% of the samples could be used without tissue culture. And this we have found a huge advantage in our practice because this means that our reports come back earlier. So previously, whenever we would do an amniocentesis at our close to 18 weeks, we were sure we will not get a report before 20 because karyotype generally takes more than 2 weeks, generally closer to 3 weeks. So with microarray, we are getting our reports earlier. So most of the cases, even when we are doing an amnio close to 18 weeks, we are able to get a report by 20 weeks. Also, they found that microarray was able to identify all the aneuploidies and unbalanced rearrangements which were identified on karyotyping, except for the balanced translocations and fetal triploidy. Triploidy, we know that most of the modern microarrays are picking up. So we were not missing out on much, but what were we gaining? So in babies where there was a structural anomaly, microarray was able to pick up a problem in 6% extra babies. And even when there was no structural abnormality in the baby, even in those, in 1.7% of the cases, microarray was able to pick up a genetic abnormality, which was not being picked up on a karyotype. So these were the mothers with advanced age or positive Down syndrome screening results. So because of these, and then these numbers have remained constant over the past several years, most of the other studies have also found this high detection rate with microarray. So both ACOG in conjunction with the Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine, RCOG and Canadian guidelines, they recommend that microarray should be offered whenever genetic analysis is performed in cases with fetal structural anomalies. Even when you are doing amniocentesis, say only for advanced maternal age or because the parents have a balanced translocation, even then you should always discuss the option of microarray. The costs have come down dramatically in the last few years, and sometimes the cost is not even that much of an issue with the parents as much as our own mindset that we don't want to go for a newer technology. Now, the third group is when you have fetuses with fetal growth restriction. Now, this has been a controversial topic for quite some time. This was a systematic review and meta-analysis published in 2018 in the Journal of Fetal Diagnosis and Therapy. They included 10 studies. Now, the only drawback was that the cutoff for fetal growth restriction was provided in only 5 studies. And as you can see, it was not uniform at that time. But they found that in non-malformed, so in malformed fetuses, we know now that microarray is the test of choice. But even if you are looking at non-malformed growth-restricted fetuses, in 4% of the cases, microarray was able to identify a genetic abnormality which was not being detected on karyotype. And these were the most common pathogenic copy number variants identified: 22q11 duplication, xp22.3 deletion, and 7p11.2 deletion syndromes. So the debate continues, and this was a wonderful French multi-center study published just a few months back in the Green Journal. And over a period of 1 year, 146 fetuses with growth restriction underwent amniocentesis regardless of POG. Now, this is because under French law, third trimester termination of pregnancy is also permissible if it is thought that the baby will be having severe handicaps. So even at 32 weeks, practically, they were doing amniocentesis in growth-restricted fetuses. They defined fetal growth restriction as estimated weight less than 10 centile on ultrasound. And they found that microarray was able to pick up a genetic abnormality in 7.5% cases. So 11 fetuses, which are mentioned here, so they had a genetic microdeletion or duplication syndrome. 3 cases, there was a variant of uncertain significance. The one case which microarray missed, it was a case here of trisomy 18 mosaicism, where there was mosaic trisomy 18 in 13% of the interface cells. And as we just studied, that less than 20 to 25% mosaicism, microarray can miss that. So they concluded that you should use microarray in addition to karyotype for fetal growth restriction. So what do our studies say? So Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine, in the recent guidelines on the diagnosis and management of fetal growth restriction, they recommend that pregnant women should be offered prenatal diagnostic testing with microarray when you have unexplained isolated fetal growth restriction at less than 32 weeks of gestation. So at our center, whenever we get isolated fetal growth restrictions at less than 24 weeks, we do discuss the option of amniocentesis with microarray and torch PCR with the prospective parents. Now, the next group is the group where there is a stillbirth. So what is the role of microarray in stillbirth evaluation? So we know that chromosomal anomalies, they account for 6 to 17% cases of stillbirth. And identification of the cause of stillbirth, it helps to predict the recurrence risk if an abnormality is found. And many times it just gives a closure to the parents. We know that conventional karyotyping, as has been our experience over the last few several years, that karyotyping using cell culture is not very successful in cases of stillbirth. The reported failure rate of karyotype has been about 25 to 55% in many series. And the reasons have been described as tissue maceration or contamination by maternal cells or bacteria. So this was a paper, beautiful paper published in 2020 in the Journal of Fetal Diagnosis and Therapy. And we know that the amniotic fluid cells and placenta, they may remain viable for longer than the fetal skin and blood cells following fetal demise. Blood cells, they become non-viable extremely quickly after human death. Skin maceration also begins quite quickly with fetuses who are maintained in the warm intrauterine environment. And bacterial or fungal contamination can occur during delivery through the birth canal. So what the authors did here was that in their 136 cases of stillbirth, they sent several tissue samples for both karyotyping and microarray. So after the delivery of the baby, we are practically left with 2 samples. One is fetal skin and the second is fetal blood. So they found that when you were sending fetal skin for a karyotype, they were able to get a successful report in only 13% of the cases. So only 7 out of 54 cases, they were able to get any report. you know, whether an abnormal or a normal one, only in 7 cases. In 47, there was no report. When they sent fetal blood in 16 cases, in only one case was the karyotype successful. In 15 cases, there was a failed karyotype. However, when they were sending amniotic fluid by amniocentesis before delivering the baby, so before they were inducing labor for stillbirth, if they sent an amniotic fluid, they were able to get a successful report in 83% cases. And when they sent a placenta by a placental biopsy, they were able to get a successful report in 78% cases. So these numbers are very poor. So they suggested that if you are opting for karyotype, it's better to put in a needle and take an amniotic fluid sample or a placental biopsy for karyotype before you induce labor and deliver the baby. But practically, we all know that this is not a very good option in most cases. The parents, the mindset is not such that then we start counseling them for all these tests. And a lot of times these facilities are also not available. However, when they were sending these samples for microarray, they found that the success rate was 100% irrespective of the tissue sampled. So when genetic testing is done in stillbirth cases, there are two main groups. One is whether you get a report or not. And the second is the kind of information that you get with the report. So in the first category, obviously, microarray is better than karyotype in terms of getting a report. Now let's look at the information with the report. So this was again a systematic review and meta-analysis in the White Journal in 2018. They included 7 studies, 900 stillborn fetuses. All of these had normal karyotype. And they found that where the fetus was structurally normal on ultrasound, microarray was able to identify an abnormality in 3% cases with a normal karyotype. If there was an abnormality, microarray identified a genetic problem in 6% cases. The most frequent pathogenic copy number variation detected was the 22q11 deletion syndrome. So because of these, now both the Stillbirth Collaborative Research Network and the Society of Maternal Fetal Medicine recommend that if you are doing genetic testing in cases of stillbirth, microarray is recommended over karyotype. Now the next group is when you are evaluating a case of recurrent pregnancy loss. So we know that in 50% cases of first trimester,
I think you need to wind up fast.
Okay, ma'am. So in 50% cases, there is a chromosomal abnormality. If we go for a karyotype in these cases, culture failure occurs in 20 to 40% cases, and false negative results have been reported in 29 to 58% cases because of the selective overgrowth of maternal cells during culture. So you get a normal fetal karyotype even if there is an underlying chromosomal abnormality. So because of this, now ASHRAE recommends in the latest 2017 guidelines that genetic analysis of pregnancy tissue is not routinely recommended, but it can be performed for explanatory purposes. If you are doing this testing, then microarray is recommended because of a reduced maternal cell contamination effect. And this has been our experience at Jindal IVF also. In the last few years, we have completely replaced karyotype now with microarray when we are evaluating first trimester abortions in patients who are able to afford the test. And as we see here, 22 patients underwent first microarray, and it was successful in 95% cases. These were the abnormalities that we picked up. Now, this is an interesting case where a 27-year-old patient came to us with a secondary infertility of 1.5 years. Her first pregnancy had a missed abortion at 8 weeks. This time the patient conceived following IUI, but again it was a missed abortion at 9 weeks. Now, this was an affording couple, highly anxious, and they wanted further testing. So when we did a microarray of the POCs, we found this deletion in chromosome 1 and a duplication in chromosome 13. So whenever we see this rearrangement, we need to look whether one of the parents is a balanced translocation carrier. And this was the case in this case where the wife was harboring a balanced translocation. And now this completely changes the counseling with for this couple. I think I'll just skip that. But what I'd like to say that even in balanced translocation carriers, so when we find an apparently balanced de novo translocation in the fetus on amniocentesis, even in these cases, there might be a cryptic gain or loss at one of the translocation breakpoints over here. So even in these cases now, microarray is recommended. So now I'll just move on to, these are all the good things with microarray, but we do several times face dilemmas with the use of microarray in prenatal diagnosis. This was elucidated in this paper published in 2012 from the NICHT clinical trials. So here was a case where they did amniocentesis for a positive Down syndrome screening. So this is a very common indication in our practice. So microarray showed that there was no Down syndrome in the baby, but there was this small deletion in the Digeorge syndrome region. So now we know that 90% of the patients with Digeorge syndrome have a larger deletion. Here the deletion was smaller. So Digeorge syndrome can be associated with heart defects in the baby. Here the fetal echo was normal. So there the phenotype is highly variable, and now these are counseling issues. A lot of times you need a very good geneticist to actually be able to tell the parents as to what to expect in the baby. Another case where they did amniocentesis for a unilateral clubfoot, and they found a de novo, a new 1.6 MB microduplication in chromosome 7. Now, this is the Willebrand syndrome critical region. There can be intellectual disability and mental retardation, hypotonia, congenital anomalies like clubfoot with this microduplication. But many parents with the same microduplication are employed and functioning well, only with a history of learning difficulties. So when you have a wide range of phenotypic spectrum, you have a lot of counseling issues. And we have faced this problem sometimes in our practice also, where some parents then opt for an MTP in these cases, whereas the other parents opt for continuation with a lot of increased anxiety. The third case was where they did CVS for advanced maternal age, and they found this maternally inherited deletion in chromosome 3, which is associated with spinocerebellar ataxia type 15. Now, this is an adult onset disorder. It has significant variable expressivity, and the affected individuals can remain ambulatory for several years. Now, this is something that the mother had not signed for. So whether you inform her that she can have a non-modifiable adult onset disease or not, so this again is an area where the counselors have to use their own discretion. And the last case here where they did a CVS for a child, for a mother where the previous child had neurodevelopmental delay because there was this genetic abnormality in chromosome 5. In the current pregnancy, that part was fine, but they found a new duplication in chromosome 1. Now, whenever you have these cases, they look at the genes involved in that area. And again, this was a variant of uncertain significance, so a lot of counseling issues. So I think just to conclude, I think we all know what a microarray detects and does not detect. And most genetic changes which are identified by microarray and which are not missed, picked up by karyotype, they are not associated with increased maternal age. So CMA or microarray should be considered for all women. Whenever you do an invasive testing, it's always a good idea to go for a microarray rather than a karyotype. And comprehensive pre-test and post-test counseling is very essential regarding the benefits, limitations, and the results of a microarray. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ritika, for a very wonderful talk. And I think you have clarified a lot of issues. But one thing, what about this high resolution and low resolution microarray?
So I think if cost is not an issue, we should go for a high resolution microarray. The resolution of microarrays is different. So depending upon the lab, a low resolution microarray might pick up micro deletions of 500 KB and micro duplications of 1 MB, while a higher resolution microarray might be able to pick up smaller micro deletions and duplications also. So I think there are some conditions like when the baby has a structural anomaly, especially a CNS anomaly, mild ventriculomegaly, those kind of things, then we always prefer a higher resolution microarray. Sometimes we're doing invasive testing only for an increased biochemical risk and the baby is structurally normal. So I think in those cases, you can go for a low resolution microarray also. But I think if cost is not an issue, then obviously if you're putting in a needle, it's better always to go for a higher resolution microarray.
Okay, then there are two questions in the chat box. One is from Dr. Usha Madan. What is the role of dual marker or quadruple marker?
So at present, we are now focusing only on the first trimester screening. So combined first trimester screen includes an NTNB scan between 11 to 13 plus 6 weeks and a dual test between 11 to 13 plus 6 weeks. This now we are routinely recommending for all pregnant women, young or old, whatever the age, all of them we are recommending a combined first trimester screening. If the dual test or the combined first trimester screening shows a low risk, then we are not going for any triple or quadruple test. We are stopping our screening for trisomy 21 there itself. If it shows a high risk, then we are either going for an invasive testing or we are counseling the parents for an invasive testing or NIPT, depending upon what are their expectations and all that. In the intermediate risk group, so when the risk is between 1 in 250 to 1 in 1,000, there has been some talk of going for a quadruple test and then again giving a combined report. But at our center, we find it easier that if there's an intermediate risk, then we counsel the parents accordingly. Some parents, they opt for an NIPT and some, they just decide to wait for an early level 2 ultrasound and then take a decision. There, I think triple tests have now been phased out at most centers. If a parent, if a couple misses the first trimester screening, so in those cases, we then offer them quadruple test. But I think triple test is now phased out. And if you have done a good first trimester screening, a lot of times what happens is the first trimester screening shows a low risk and then the parents get a triple or a quadruple and then that shows a high risk and then there's a lot of controversy. So dual is a better test than quadruple. The detection rate for first trimester screening is 90% for trisomy 21. For quadruple, it is 80%. So once you've done a good test, I think we stop there and then we don't go for further quadruple. If we have missed the first trimester screening, then we go for a quadruple test.
Okay, there's another question by Dr. Inderjeet. Can FISH detect mosaicism less than 20%?
I think Dr. Sangeeta would be a better person to answer that, but even FISH can miss mosaicism. So the standard test for mosaicism is a karyotype where we look at more number of cells. FISH can pick up mosaicism. So there have been case reports where cases of mosaicism which were missed by a karyotype and microarray were picked up by FISH and then vice versa also. So I think the standard test for mosaicism is still karyotype.
Yeah, I think FISH is also not, mosaicism may not be able to pick up that much. Okay, and is nether bone included as a criterion combined screening test? It's by Chakshush Chaudhary.
So yes, it is. So if the nasal bone is unossified in your first trimester scan, and it actually depends upon the information that you provide. So if the sonographer or the radiologist has only looked at nuchal translucency and there is no comment on nasal bone, then the lab can give you a risk with only NT, TAPA and free beta HCG. If they have mentioned a nasal bone absent, then I think most of the good labs now are incorporating that for first trimester screening also. So generally the risk comes out to be pretty high. So it depends upon the lab also. So like the labs that we are sending, they are incorporating an absent nasal bone while giving this.
And the last question we'll take here is, do we offer NIPT when we have a clear-cut USG anomaly? I think the answer is very clear, no. Then it has to be an amnio or a CBS. With that, thank you, Ritika. And if there are any more questions, please write in the chat box. Dr. Ritika would be very happy to answer there. And now we move on to our third talk. Dr. Sheetal Jindal, she's going to talk about the role of PGT in monogenic disorders and how we the steps for this PGT and then how we go about it. Dr. Sheetal, please take over.
Thank you, ma'am. Is my... there is
we can see your slides visible, yeah just make the slide show we can see your slides
just 1 minute please I think there is yeah So I think the talks were excellent by the previous two speakers. Mine is slight away. It's a little towards the IVF side and I would be discussing PGT for monogenic disorders. So we are all aware of monogenic disorders are mutations of a single gene and they usually follow Mendelian pattern of inheritance. occurrence as reported in various literatures are 4 to, we still see 4 to, and the rate of occurrence of monogenic disorders is 4 to 5 per 1,000 live births, which is not less. It is quite a large number. And definitely they cause high morbidity, mortality, and a child with a disorder like that is a economic burden on the parents, and the morbidity and mortality associated is very high. And definitely genotype-phenotype correlation is consistent, but yes, variations in intensity are seen. This is where they pose sometimes diagnostic dilemmas and also. And treatments are mainly preventive, though few therapeutic options in some of the disorders are being made available now due to gene therapy. So these are the various types of monogenic disorders we know of. Autosomal dominant, in which we all know there is a 50% chance of affected offspring. One of the examples is a myotonic dystrophy, which is a triplet repeat disorder, autosomal dominant. Autosomal recessive, there is a 25% chance of having an affected offspring, and 25% of the offsprings would be normal, and 50% with carrier. The commonest autosomal recessive disorder is a beta thalassemia. Now, X-linked dominant is if the females are affected. If the female is having an X-linked dominant disorder, then 50% of the males would be affected, and 50% of the females would be affected because one of the X's is affected. And the example is a Rett syndrome. And however, if the males are affected, then all daughters would be affected because they would be getting the X from the male and sons would be probably normal. In X-linked recessive disorders, usually as we see in DMD, all the males are affected and the females are usually carriers. So I will straight away come to the treatments. Yes, once we have a couple, who is having a, we have a monogenic disorder in place, and definitely the problems are so much that the couples would definitely seek, they would definitely want for the next pregnancy, they would obviously think of the various treatment options. One is, and the various options which are available are, they come to us, they are, a lot of them would have a diagnosis in hand, and a lot of them, the diagnosis also would not be there in hand. And the treatment, but they definitely seek treatment. They don't want this to repeat in the subsequent pregnancies. And the various options which these couples would usually know of is a spontaneous conception followed by a chorionic villus sampling. And, second is the newer thing, which is now there is an established treatment modality is IVF with pre-implantation genetic testing for these monogenic disorders. And third is a gamete change. You change one of the gametes and probably, the disorder can be taken care of. So now if we compare all the three techniques in a conventional prenatal diagnosis, the timing of genetic analysis is usually by a chorionic villus sampling or by an amniocentesis between 11 to 15 weeks. However, this is done during pregnancy, but there is a slight risk of miscarriage to the tune of 1 to 2%. And the accuracy of genetic analysis by the current methodologies which are available is more than 99%. And there is a chance of healthy delivery to the tune of 75% in case of an autosomal recessive disease. But the major drawback is that there is a need to terminate the affected pregnancy, which can have significant psychosocial impact. And the major benefits of this are that it is a very well-validated procedure, and we now have a vast experience, with respect to this method. The second method, which is a newer one, which has come up since the past 25 years, is the PGTM. And the timing of the genetic analysis is before the initiation of pregnancy and the embryo transfer, that is during the ART. So you can select your genetic risk. And risk to the fetus is same as any, risk is associated with any conventional ART. The accuracy of genetic analysis, it has improved, but there is a misdiagnosis rate of 2%. With the current amplification methods and with NGS in place, yes, the accuracy of genetic analysis has increased up to 99%. And chance of healthy delivery is same, almost similar to the conventional IVF, which is 30% per embryo transfer. But the major drawback is it is technically challenging. It is labor-intensive procedure. Even in fertile couples, ART is required, and unpredictable pregnancy and live birth rates, and it is relatively costly at this point of time. But major benefits are that the termination, which is quite painstaking, is avoided. And the third technique, which is now coming up, which is still going to take time as far as monogenic testing is concerned, is non-invasive prenatal diagnosis from the maternal blood drawn at 9 weeks of pregnancy. But this still needs to be extensively validated. And it has still that problem of pregnancy termination. So these are the common monogenic disorders which have been reported in India by Anila Venugopal in 2018. And beta thalassemia, we don't have a very clear-cut data with regards to PGTN, the disorders which are, but these are the disorders which are, commonly mentioned. Beta thalassemia, sickle cell disease, DMD, hemophilia, Huntington's disease, and neurofibromatosis type 1. So now coming to PGTN. PGTN stands for pre-implantation genetic testing for monogenic disorders. It is a tool to embryo selection of a genetically normal embryo in at-risk couples. And PGTN, the biggest advantage of PGTN is that it is largely preventive. Now, what are the indications of PGTN? PGTN can be given to all the couples with a personal or family history of a high risk, for severe monogenic diseases, as in autosomal dominant, autosomal recessive, and any X-linked disorders. So where the gene in question is known, we have a genetic diagnosis in hand. In almost all those cases, PGTN can be applied. And the second area where PGT has a huge role is in HLA typing, where HLA matched embryos can be used in thalassemia cases. Now, coming to the procedure, the first and foremost, as I already said, in PGTN is the detailed genetic consultation and medical history review. The genetic diagnosis has to be confirmed at the molecular level, and only then, once we have the diagnosis in hand, it requires an extensive pre-PGT workup, where the proper probes are designed and the genetic diagnosis. Whatever genetic diagnosis we have, it is in the pre-PGT workup. The test is specifically designed for that couple so that to improve the diagnostic accuracy. Once that is in place, we do a standard ICSI procedure, the standard IVF stimulation followed by all ICSI. Usually the cultivation of the embryos is done either to day 3 or day 5. Day 3 biopsy is being increasingly replaced by day 5 biopsy because we have more number of trophoepithelium cells and at hand, leading to more output of the DNA. And followed by embryo freezing. And the trophoepithelium biopsied cells are then sent to the PGT lab for their diagnostic for the genetic testing. It is in our center, we follow the freeze all policy. And once we have the result in hand, and if we see it can be combined with the PGT as well, if you PGTA testing, or as the case may be, and followed by an embryo transfer, and definitely a postnatal confirmation of the baby's genotype. So now if we come to counseling in PGTN, yes, it has to be IVF related and there has to be a thorough genetic counseling. IVF, you have to talk to the couples about embryo pooling because in a lot of cases, to get those number of embryos that you're able to generate a minimum of 4 to 5 blastocysts, we might end up giving two stimulations to the lady, and you have to talk about the cause. You have to tell the couples about the freeze all policy, because usually the genetic diagnosis and the results are available in 2 to 3 weeks. And there is a possibility that we might end up having not even a single embryo, genetically normal embryo for transfer. So all these counselings have to be given to the couple before we enroll them into the PGT program. And even before the IVF counseling, genetic counseling is very, very important. The PGT-M can only be performed once we have an accurate genetic diagnosis in our hand, and followed by an extensive pre-PGT workup, where testing of the required family members, depending on the disease and of both the partners, is done, and the testing strategy is planned. And definitely we need a karyotype report of both the partners. So pre-PGT workup has a very important role in PGTM. So pre-PGT workup is nothing but development of the testing methodology, which is as to how the disease in question is going to be picked up in the embryo. And there are various ways in which it is done. It can be done by direct testing or by indirect testing. And usually the principle of all these tests is to pick up is to pick up the haplotypes. It is a haplotype based testing in which various STR markers are identified in the genome, various STR markers are identified along with the gene in question, so that we can be more sure, so that the diagnostic accuracy can be improved. So these are the various pre-PGT analysis techniques which are used. Most commonly performed is the targeted amplification. Basically, the issue in pre-PGT is that the amount of DNA which we have in our hand is very less. It is almost to the tune of just 10 to 50 picograms. So this whole amount of DNA has this low amount of DNA has to be amplified so that we can do the genetic diagnosis. So the various techniques through which the amplification can be done are usually PCR based, multiplex PCR based, or by whole genome amplification. And after the DNA is, but the problem with so much of amplification is that there can be issues of allele dropouts, there can be issues of poor amplification, and all these problems can lead to misdiagnosis. So once the pre-PGT analysis, we look for the disease in question is the gene in question is targeted along with the STR markers, which are flanking the additional regions along with the gene in question. And those STR markers improve the diagnostic accuracy, and that is how we are more sure about the genetic diagnosis of the embryo being tested. So this is how these are STR markers are the short end. So we are all very well aware that there are alleles. There are alleles which are, this is allele A and this is allele B. This is the genetic disease in, what we are talking of. Along with that, flanking the gene locus of interest, we have STR markers. These STR markers are short tandem repeats of DNA, which are seen in the entire genome. And on the basis of the fragment size of these STR markers, we are more sure about the allele which we are selecting, whether that is an affected allele or that is a non-affected allele. So this is how, depending on the different length of the PCR products, we haplotype, the wild allele, which is not affected, and that is the embryo which is considered for transfer. So these were the few cases I just wanted to describe about the SDR markers as to how this is planned, how this is done in PGT. So this was a case in which the husband was a known case of autosomal dominant myotonic dystrophy, and the couple had one normal baby. The second was terminated because it was an NTP, medical termination of pregnancy, because it was affected. Now the couple was suffering from secondary infertility, and so they wished to take IVF with PGT. Now once we did two cycles of IVF in them, and after that this is the final report of the patient which we got. So this is the pre-PGT workup which was done, and this is the CTG repeat which was diagnosed, and all these are the STR markers which were compared between the patient and the partner. A fully informed STR marker is the one which has a different amplicon size on all the four alleles. And so that is why, so this marker, so we are more sure that this is the type, this is the, so if that gets segregated, that is the one which will be, so that improves our diagnostic confidence in the embryo which we are transferring. So this was another case, which is a 35 years old couple with previous child with intellectual disability and dysmorphism. Evaluation revealed a compound heterozygosity of LRP2 gene, which was suggestive of Donnai-Barrow syndrome, which is an autosomal recessive disorder. And parents were heterozygous carrier of the same mutation. The couple had one MTP for affected baby on chorionic villus sampling. And so they wanted IVF with PGTN. However, the question in this, she was a 35 years old lady. She had an average ovarian reserve with an AMH of 1 nanogram per ml. So we did the pre-PGT workup in this patient. So all the STR markers which were detected were semi-informative in the patient as well as the partner. And because there were multiple markers which were tested, so according and with the disease in question, with the so it was possible in these cases we could have been more sure with the diagnosis. So this was another case of adult onset leukodystrophy. Here, this was a very interesting case in which because this is an adult onset problem, the partner's husband did not want to get himself tested for the disease. The husband's mother was affected and she had died. So the lab took the samples of the patient, the partner, as well as the father. And specific polymorphic STR markers were picked up, which had come from the husband, which had come from the patient's father. And they were compared and they were linked with the patient herself. And all the STR markers which were coming from the husband's side were not taken into consideration. So this is how the embryos, we are still awaiting the report of this patient. And once, if we have a normal embryo in hand, we would plan the transfer. So coming to the limitations of PGT, yes, it requires ovarian stimulation. The success is limited and the cost of the procedure is high. And as far as genetics is concerned, the mutation has to be known. And a proper pre-PGT workup, if we are able to localize and if we are able to haplotype with the help of the STR markers, the lab is going to tell us whether PGT is possible in these cases or not. And definitely, as far as genetic analysis is concerned, there could be a possibility of no DNA being detected. There is a possibility of contamination by extraneous DNA. And genetic recombination is something, which can occur in the embryo itself, and that is beyond our control. And definitely, as I already discussed, the allele dropout. And legals, depending on, you know, country to country, yes, like in many European countries, biopsying the embryos is not permitted. So, you know, these are the major limitations, you know, which can, you know, which are there with while we are doing PGT for monogenic disorders. So these are the few cases which are currently going on in our center. As I mentioned, this is a case of Turner-Barrow syndrome, which is an autosomal recessive disorder. We have done the pre-PGT workup of this patient, and the stimulation is still due. And a case of myotonic dystrophy in which, you know, after the pre-PGT workup, two stimulations were done. However, to our surprise, we could just make one blastocyst out of all the stimulations which were possible. And a single embryo transfer was done. And unfortunately, the patient did not conceive. And so this is one of the biggest limitations of PGT, that in spite of putting so much of an effort, you might still end up with a negative result. And we have another common condition, you know, in which it is an autosomal dominant polycystic, adult onset polycystic kidney disease, and for which the pre-PGT workup is going on. And once we are through with that, definitely the couple is going to be taken up for IVF, and you know, let's see how the results are. So there is a case of further recurrent abortions with both partners having beta thalassemia minor. But the problem additional in this case is that, this couple, was even in spite of having 2 to 3 MTPs for beta thalassemia minor, I did give them the option of PGT. They are still, considering, because cost is a major concern for them. So a lot of times PGT comes to a halt because patients do feel that, they will have, means they want to buy time to, you know, as the procedure is costly. And the result of this case is awaited. And there is another case with previous 4 abortions, 2 MTPs for beta thalassemia major, and couple is heterozygous, heterozygous for both the couples, both the partners are heterozygous for beta thalassemia minor, but the child additionally had major spinal defects, and we did a high resolution microarray for the baby and it was inconclusive. So this is a case, you know, which just tells us that not all abnormalities are genetic in origin. The microarray was inconclusive. Yes, this couple is a case, you know, which can, we can take care of the beta thalassemia major. We can just check the disease in question with PGTM. And, you know, but still, you know, we are not very sure that, you know, whether PGTM and A would be able to solve their problems, because this couple had 2 additional, babies in which there were major other malformations which were noted. So this is what is the issue. Thank you for your patient hearing.
Yeah. Thank you, Sheetal. I think it was a very brief overview for everyone. And there are a few questions. Dr. Inderjeet, she has raised a question regarding donor IVF. So should we do a PGD for donor IVF to prevent legal issues, and how would you counsel these patients? I would rather say you can talk about donor screening also a little bit.
Yeah, so donor screening for the common, in fact, extended carrier screening is something which is which is going to pick up in the future. So for the common disorders like thalassemia, spinal muscular atrophy, DMDs, hemophilias, yes, it has a role, and and few of the couples also, once they are enrolling themselves in the donor program, they do ask for screening of the donors, for the common disorders. But yes, we are currently not doing it, but there are panels which are available, which are, screening donors for the common disorders.
One thing I would like to emphasize here is that PGT-A screening is only for gross aneuploidies. You cannot do a very wide kind of testing in PGT-A. You have to know the abnormal mutation in the parents to be able to direct your PGT-M investigation toward a specific gene. So that is the difference between PGT-M and PGT-A, what we call it, screening for aneuploidy that we do for like advanced age women that where you can do and to improve the success rate for IVF or in cases of RPL. But in cases of PGT-M, you have to know the diagnosis beforehand to direct. So once you are doing a donor program, it is better to screen the donors or the than PGT-M, because PGT-M will be done if anything is found there. And with that, we would like to thank everyone for their active participation, and most of the audience, they are staying till end, and that is very encouraging for us that you have liked the sessions, you are with us, and let's hope that we'll come back again with some more interesting cases or discussions or panels. And we would definitely like to have your feedbacks commonly. And if we get more questions, we'll be very happy to organize more meetings and answer those questions. Would anybody like, Dr. Priyadarshini, would you like to say anything here?
Yeah, so thank you very much. I think all three talks were excellent. In fact, I was discussing with our marketing, with Joseph, who is part of our marketing team, that in fact, we should learn from these talks. You know, they were so well presented, and the content also was very, very scientific and helpful. I'm sure all the clinicians felt the same. So thank you very much to you, madam, and to all the speakers for giving such a wonderful session. Thank you for participation, thanks for your time. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mesh Jindal, for providing us this opportunity to present to this audience. And we hope to be part of more such sessions in the future. And also wishing all of you all happy World IVF Day coming up on Sunday, July 25th.
Yeah, thank you. And thank you, Marjanom, for joining us and partnering with us. And we would like to have more sessions with you. Thank you.
Definitely, ma'am.
Thank you. Have a good evening, everybody. Bye-bye.
I'll be ending the session now. Good evening and happy weekend to everybody.